So yesterday we discussed the effect of vortex correction, and we saw that one of the effects of corrections of this kind was that the electron acquires an anomalous magnetic moment. Right? The G of the electron is not exactly 2, but 2 plus small correction, which you can calculate. So today we are going to do something similar, but for a different graph. We will study some effect of vacuum polarization. So let me label this. This is E minus E. This carries index mu, this carries nu. And then there is a fermion fermion group. So the general structure of this is of the form pi mu nu of E. I'll also put an I here. Okay, this is just convention, that's how I'll define pi. And the idea is that if this graph is represented by computed to be pi mu nu of E, then the same contribution you can get from an effective action, just from three level calculation from an effective action, which is of the following kind. We have integral d4p over 2 pi to d4, a tilde mu r of minus e, pi mu nu of e, a tilde and you have to now put a half factor. This half is due to the fact that when you try to calculate two point function of the A's from here, there will be two contributions. One where the first A gets contracted with this, the second A to this, and second one is the vice versa. Okay, and those two contributions are the same. So this will give a contribution of half times twice I pi mu nu, and that's what matches this I pi. Is this point clear? Yesterday we didn't have to worry about this because there is psi bar and a psi, right? So a psi can only contract with psi bar and not psi, that's why there is a factor of 2. But today, because this is a real field, there will be a factor of 2. Okay, when you contract, calculate 2 point function from here. Now, the other thing which I didn't mention yesterday is that the effective action that you construct is BRST invariant. Right? Because all the Feynman rules are BRST invariant, so the effective action that you have construct, so the original action was BRST invariant, you are now adding new terms, okay, which are just encoding the result of the loop calculations. So that new terms should also be BRST invariant. Okay? So the sum of the original action and the new action should be BRST invariant. And that puts constraint on these various functions that appear here. Okay, for arbitrary choice of these functions, it will not be BRST invariant. Okay, and we will see an example today. Okay. Now, it is not that you have to impose this. Okay, if you actually do the calculation, you will find it automatically. Okay. The only thing you have to worry is that if the regularization that you are using is not invariant under BRST, okay, then you have to adjust the counter terms, particularly the finite parts of the counter terms, to make sure that you get a BRST invariant. Because if the regularization is not BRST invariant, then you have to compensate for it by using explicit terms in the action which cancel the effect. But if the regularization is BRST invariant, then you don't have to worry about this. And for QED, of course, we know that there is a BRST invariant regularization, which is dimensional regularization. Right? Because nothing that we have said about BRST depends on the dimension. Okay? We could have worked in any dimension. Okay? For standard model, on the other hand, this is not quite true. Because of this gamma 5, right? Because gauge transformation involves gamma 5 and that is not defined away from 4 dimensions. Okay, so there you have to be a little more careful. Okay, so we will use dimensional regularization. So whatever be the consequences of BRST will be automatic. So what is the consequence of BRST? So first, let's notice just from Lorentz invariance. I mu nu of p will be given by epsilon of p times eta mu nu is p square f2 of p square p mu. This is the most general structure that you can write down that is consistent with Lorentz invariance. Is this clear? Now, here is the invariance. It implies that the epsilon of p square is equal to minus p square f2 of p square. So that this is actually in the combination e square eta mu nu minus p mu p nu. Okay, so this is pi mu nu. P then has a structure of e square, sorry, f2 of e square times e square minus e square eta mu nu. Now, it's not hard to see why this is the case. Because after all, BRST invariance acting on gauge fields is just gauge transformation, right? With the transformation parameters given by zeta times C A of X, right? So, delta A mu will be the derivative of zeta times C A, right? Or zeta times del mu of C A. So, in the momentum space, this corresponds to shifting A mu by P mu times C A. Correct? Del mu of C A is P mu times C A. This combination, if you hit by P mu is 0. Okay? So if you change the gauge field by something proportional to P mu, this gives you 0. But in general, if F1 and F2 had been different, arbitrary, then this would not be 0. Right? Because you will get, if you multiply it by P mu, you will get a P mu from here, and you will get a P square times P mu from here. Right? And in fact, demanding that equal to 0 gives you this relation between F1 and F2. Is this part here?
So,
one identity. Yeah, so BRST invariance is one identity, right? The consequences of BRST invariance are the one identities. Is this okay? So, again, this is something that you don't have to assume, right? If you use dimensional regular asset, which of course respects gauge invariance, you should automatically find that this relation works. F1 and F2 are related by this. Yeah, but without doing calculation, you would have said that this would hold just because of the RST invariance, right? That's the...
Sir,
yes.
Here maybe it is true, but means if one just calculate any correlation function, there is other loops, suppose there is gluon loops,
yes.
Then that is not, means we are still in, we have to add the ghost loop also, then only
yes,
we can get this structure.
True. Yes, exactly. So you have to add everything, right? For QED, if you use the del mu mu equal to 0, that is, if you use the gauge fixing term with del mu mu, then the ghost is free, right? That's why there is no ghost loop. Otherwise, in the definition of pi mu nu, you should include everything,
yeah.
Right? And the sum should be BRST invariant, right? Not individual diagrams. Right? In fact, the reason that you need the ghost is to compensate for the gauge non-invariance of the other part of the diagrams, right? So clearly, you will need to include all that, everything. Is this okay? Okay, so I'll describe some aspects of calculating pi mu nu. But before I do that, let's just see what it will mean for the propagator. So the quadratic part of the action, quadratic in between the loop part of the action, oh I should have said that this is of course, with this you have to add this. Okay. I am always assuming that we remove the divergence in the counter term. Okay. otherwise probably you will not be able to find it. So the original term was half integral d4 t over 2 pi d4 plus a gauge fixing, which I'll talk about later. And to this, you now add this. Okay? So you add this plus this one. Plus this new term that we got, okay, this pi mu nu piece. Right, which came from this plus the counter term, we just add together. So this you can easily see that gives you half integral d4 p d4 1 minus f2 of p square . Okay, basically what happens is that the structure remains the same, okay, except that you multiply by 1 minus f2 of p square. Okay, 1 minus f2 of p square, this, once you put this relation, okay, this again becomes p square eta mu nu minus p mu p nu with an f2 of p square multiplying. Now the point I want to make is that this part, the p mu p nu part, can be removed by gauge fixing. Right? Original gauge fixing term was such that it just removed this term. Right? Original choice of H A, right? If you took just a del mu a Feynman gauge, for example, right? When you take H A equal to del mu A mu and take alpha equal to 1, that just removes the p mu p nu part. Right? That's how you got the Feynman. Now you can continue to choose the same gauge, okay, in which case you will not remove the whole thing, they will be left with this f2 of p square gauge. Okay. But of course the choice of gauge is up to us, right? We can change the choice of gauge at one look if we want. Okay, the final result shouldn't depend on the physical result shouldn't depend on the choice of gauge. So by choosing the gauge appropriately, we can just remove this whole thing. Okay. Now basically H, the gauge fixing function, I'll, in the momentum space, I'll choose in such a way that it includes p nu a nu, but multiplied by square root of 1 minus f. Okay, so when you square it, you get 1 minus f times p nu a nu square, and that exactly cancels this term. Is this point clear?
The second.
Yes. Second term. The p nu p nu. Right? This part, of course, you cannot cancel, but the p nu part, because it's in the form of square of something, right? P nu A nu, right, is a combination, that's the del mu A mu. Right? Similarly, P mu A mu, that's again del mu A mu. So it's the square of something, except that in momentum space, it gets multiplied by 1 minus F2. Okay? So you have to multiply the gauge fixing function by the square root of 1 minus F2, that's the additional thing. Okay? So that when you square it, the whole thing gets cancelled. Okay? Now you may worry about taking square root of 1 minus F2, but F2 you have to remember is small, right? It's already of order V square. So square root of 1 minus f2 is just 1 minus half f2 to this order. Right? So there is nothing peculiar about taking the square root. So mainly the point I am trying to emphasize is that this part can be gotten rid of. Okay? and we have the analog of a Feynman type propagator, except that we have this multiplicative factor of 1 minus f2 in the kinetic term. So if we get rid of this, if we cancel this, then what are left with is half integral d4 over 2 pi to d4 1 minus f2 of t square. So the modified propagator that we'll get, modified photon propagator, is minus I over t square eta medium 1 over 1 minus f2 of t square. Okay, which to this order I can also write as minus I over t square eta mu 1 plus t square. Is clear? So if you calculate f2, then this procedure tells you how to calculate a modified propagator, modified proton propagator. So later on, we'll see the effect of this, what it does. Okay, it does many things. One of the effects of this, okay, in particular on the hydrogen atom, right, what this does. But let's just go ahead and describe how to calculate pi value. Okay, I'll not again give the full details, but I'll just give the outline of how it's done. Calculate pi value, you have to let label momentum. So let's call this L, or let's call this P minus L. Then basically, we are trying to look for this loop, so you have integral d4l over 2 pi to d4. Then there's a trace. It's a trace because it's a forward loop. Right? Because you start from here, you start putting in gamma matrices, and at the end, you're back to the same index. Right? You start with alpha beta, say this is alpha beta gamma delta, right? So you get gamma mu alpha beta. Okay, let me write this and then you can put the indices if you want. So I gamma mu, okay, that this is mu. Then we have minus I p slash minus l slash plus m over p minus l are difference, right? Then you have I gamma mu
from that vortex,
and then you have minus I times, here you see L is flowing opposite to the arrow, so it's really minus L slash on top, minus L slash L square, and that's where it closes. If you put the indices, suppose you didn't worry about the trace, you didn't write trace, then it will be I gamma nu, you see alpha beta, okay, you are going opposite the arrow, then alpha beta, then this will be beta del beta gamma, okay, this propagator, then there will be gamma delta, well I should have, yeah, gamma delta, and this would be delta alpha, right, this propagator, delta alpha, okay. So basically you will start with an index alpha here, end with an index alpha, that's trace, okay. That's why you are getting a trace, while you calculate phi by formula. And there is an ER squared, because the two factors, and then times numerical factor. Okay, these numerical factors are of various kinds, right? First of all, there is one over two factorial, because you are using this same vortex twice. Then you have to look at the combinatorial factor. And then also you have to worry about the minus signs, because they are contraction of formulas. So you have to arrange the formulas in appropriate order, psi bar psi here, psi bar psi here, and then you see psi bar here gets contact with psi there, psi here gets contact with psi bar there, right? You have to see how many times the things cross, right? And that will give an extra minus sense. All of those you have to keep track of, and that's what goes into the numerical factor. Is this clear? And the general rule is that whenever you have a formula loop, you get a minus sign, right? But that minus sign comes basically because there are odd number of crossings, right? You can check. You don't have to assume that rule. Just write it as psi bar psi and psi bar psi and try to contract, and you will see what you get. Basically psi bar psi. Anyway, you can do it yourself and see. Okay, that you have to exchange the order of psi and psi bar, okay, and you get a minus sign. Okay, so now it should be clear how to evaluate this, right? That first you have to combine denominators, right? This is in fact easier than the diagram that we considered yesterday, where two denominators. Okay? So you have two Feynman parameters, in fact only one integral, right? Because there is a delta function. So we'll combine denominators. So the first step is to combine denominators. So this gives you something like d alpha 1, d alpha 2, delta 1 minus alpha 1 minus alpha 2. Then you have to shift L to L tilde, which is L plus something. Okay, and the idea is that in terms of this L tilde, the denominator should look like 1 over L tilde square plus something square. Okay, no linear term in L in the denominator. Is it clear? Okay, that's the general rule. Then you can integrate easily. Then you have to also simplify numerator. Simplify numerator. And there you can take help of the Gamma matrix algebra. Right? I mean, case of Gamma matrices have various identities that you have to use to try to simplify the numerator. The integral, of course, is divergent, right? It's in fact quadratically divergent because there are two factors of L in the numerator, four in the denominator, right? And four integrals, so it's quadratically divergent. But in dimensional regularization, you can do those integrals. Right? You'll get poles, but otherwise there is no problem. So you go ahead and carry out those integrals. So the fine at the end of this, what will be end left with is integral 0 to 1 d alpha 1 of something. Alpha 2, I am not writing because of this delta function. Right? It's really one integral. Then alpha 2 can you can replace by 1 minus alpha 1. Okay, wherever alpha 2 will appear. So first exercise is to check that y mu nu is proportional to e squared eta mu nu minus p. This in fact happens even before an encounter. But this is divergent. Coefficient that appears here is divergent, right? So you have to remove it by adding counter terms. And the counter term that you add to remove the divergences. Remove divergences by adding counter term. And the counter term that you have to add basically comes from the wave function normalization of A. You remember you have an f mu nu term, right? So when you scale A to Z times AR, that f mu nu term gets the multiplicative factor of Z. Right? A you can scale to Z tilde to half times AR. Right? You get multiplicative factor of Z tilde A. Right? And that's exactly proportional to P square eta mu nu minus P mu nu, right? Because this is f mu nu. In momentum space. Okay. So basically, you have to adjust Z tilde A to cancel this. Adjust Z tilde A to cancel this. I should have put MR here. Okay, all the parameters that I am going to use are all normalized parameters. Okay, because we are using the standard normalization procedure. Okay, so the, in the loops and all, it's MR. Okay, so I'll not write the final result, but it's reasonably straightforward to verify. plus a constant. This constant is a finite part of the normalization. Okay? The constant piece of F2 you cannot fix. Okay? You cannot fix because when you add counter term proportional to this, you can always add a finite constant times this. Because Z is determined, it's Z 1 plus an infinite constant plus a finite constant. That finite constant will have the effect of changing F2, shifting F2 by a constant. Okay? So this you cannot fix. But of course, the final result shouldn't be dependent on this. Right? So you can basically adjust the Z tilde A such that this constant is 0. Okay, this is convention. Okay, so other than that, this is your F2. So what can it do to us? If we have gotten F2, that means we got know the modified photon propagator. Right? The photon propagator is not 1 over 2 square, but 1 over 2 square times 1 plus F2. So this means that when you talk about interaction between charges, right? Say suppose you are looking at the static interaction between charges. It of course has many other consequences, dynamical consequences, but suppose you are just looking at a static interaction between charges. That 1 over r Coulomb potential that you get for the charges, that comes from the Fourier transform of the photon propagator, right? You look at the Q0 equal to 0, okay, take a photon momentum, a zero momentum photon, and Fourier transform, okay, that gives you, that is the Fourier transform of 1 over e vector square. And that gives you the 1 over r. Is that, that's a Coulomb interaction, right? Static charges, so you don't, the photon that is being exchanged carries no zero component, okay, but spatial component, that's what generates the 1 over r. But now, if the photon propagator changes, then the effective interaction between the charges will change. Right? It will not be 1 over r anymore. Right? The leading piece will still have the 1 over r, but there will be correction. So those corrections you can in principle calculate systematically because you know what F2 is.
So what is
C?
Pardon?
What is C1? What is C1? No, alpha 1.
Alpha 1?
Oh, this is a bracket.
Oh.
Yeah. Alpha 1 times 1 minus alpha 1. Yeah, this is just a pure integral. It's given only as functions of P square minus M square. Okay, so the idea is that once you have this new function F2 of p square, then you can calculate in particular how the static interaction between two electrons change. Okay, you can also ask more dynamical questions. If the electrons are moving fast, then what kind of change takes place? There you will need the full details of all components of p. But let's focus on the static case. Okay. And let's also do an approximation. So we'll make an approximation where we'll take E square to be small compared to MR square. Okay, so let's see what this means. So MR to leading order is the physical mass of the electron. And then there is a collection of order ER squared, okay? To leading order, MR is like the physical mass of the electron. So when we say that we look at the photon momentum squared, that is small compared to MR squared, we are thinking of, say, processes where the variation, okay, photon momentum is, the photon wavelength is 1 over the photon momentum. So we are talking about a photon wavelength, okay, that is large compared to 1 over m, which is a Compton wavelength of the electron. Right? 1 over m, c I have said equal to 1, right? So 1 over m is a Compton Compton radius of the electron. Okay? So we are talking about distance scales larger than a Compton radius, right? So if you are considering processes where the variation, okay, the rate of variation of the wave function is over a Compton radius is small. Okay, that means that the variation occurs at a larger scale compared to the Compton radius of the electron, then this approximation you expect to be good.
Means then we are not considering photon going to electron-positron pair. Means only quantum mechanics will work in that limit.
Yes. So roughly only quantum mechanics will work, right? I mean, you are looking at a photon momentum that is not producing electron-positron pair, but also that the photon momentum is much smaller than that threshold, right? So that effectively we are the scale over which the wave functions vary, right? That will be like 1/2. Okay? The scale over which the wave functions vary, that's the atomic scale, right? That scale is much larger than the Compton radius of the electron. Okay, that's the assumption. Okay, Compton radius, you can calculate 1/m, right? That's much smaller than the scale over the wave function of the electron in the hydrogen atom. So if we make this approximation, this is not necessary, okay, but let's do this, then life will be simpler. Then you can actually find an analytic expression for this expansion. Okay, so what you will do is you will take p square over m square to be small and expand it out. Okay, then it is as a power series. Okay. And once it's given as a power series, we can actually do the alpha integrals. Okay. So the first contribution to F2 of E square will be minus 2 ER square by pi integral 0 to 1 d alpha 1 alpha 1 1 minus alpha 1. Okay. And this is log of 1 over 1 minus x, okay, for small x is like log of 1 plus x, okay, which starts as x. Okay, 1 over 1 minus x, I first wrote 1 plus x, okay, and then you use the fact that log of 1 plus x, the expansion starts at x. So I can write e square over mr square alpha 1, 1 minus alpha, plus ordered e square over mr square whole square. Is this clear? Okay, so this integral now is elementary, right? Alpha 1 integral, so you can easily do it. And this gives you minus mr square over 50 mr square.
Can you do pi?
Pi, yes, 15 pi. So let's now see its effect on the propagator. So the propagator, the photon propagator, is minus I over p square beta mu 1 plus x. So this gives you minus I over p square beta mu 1 minus r square over 15 pi mr square m p square. So this, let's just take the p square inside and it will become clear what it does. Minus I eta mu 1 over p square minus e square over 15 phi inverse. Okay, so the first correction is a phi independent constant. Okay, this is a standard photon propagator. This is responsible for the Coulomb interaction. But then there is a phi independent constant. So this is the Green's function, right? So the position space representation of this is basically going to generate the electrostatic potential. Right? In the static case, so in the static case, what you do for this part? So you can take P0 equal to 0. Photon propagator, and then we basically not P0 equal to 0, we replace P square basically by P vector square, thinking that the P0 component is small, and then you do a Fourier transform. Okay? Fourier transform, this is the position space Green's function, right? That's what is responsible for the interaction. Okay? So look at the position space Green's function. Then, because there is no P0 dependence, you get a delta of T. Okay, that's the instantaneous interaction. And then 1 over T vector square gives you the 1 over Coulomb potential. Okay, that's one way of arriving at the Coulomb potential, right? The Coulomb potential is an instantaneous potential between the two.
Sir, P0 is 0.
Basically, you can say that the relevant part of T that will contribute is when P0 is much, much smaller than P0. Okay, if you have two static potential, static charges, right, and we are calculating the interaction between the two, right? See, in general, see what is going to happen, that this interaction is never instantaneous, right? But for non-relativistic problem, you can ignore the fact that there is a time that that is required for the signal to propagate, right? So, as if the interaction is instantaneous, right? And that's equivalent to saying that we are assuming that P0 is much, much smaller than P vector, right? The part of P0 that contributes. Basically, you look at a fixed separation, right? And you assume that the processes are not changing too much in time. Okay, that's an approximation. You never have instantaneous interaction, right? If you have two objects, right? If you move one, it always takes C times T, D or C, or distance over C for the signal to propagate. Okay? But instantaneous interaction is a good approximation for hydrogen atom, for example, right? But things are not very moving very fast. Okay, so that's the approximation. But in any case, for our problem, I don't even need to worry about this, right? We know how to get Coulomb potential out of Green's function, right? We are interested in the correction. Okay? Correction is P independent. So it's Fourier transform. So the Fourier transform is e to the I e dot x times a constant, right? E4 t over 2 by 2 e4 times constant. Okay, for this part. So this is just delta of P delta Q of X. Is this clear? So this means that the effect of this correction is an instantaneous contact interaction. Okay, that the potential gets a turn that takes over only when the two charges are separated by zero distance, and it's instantaneous. Right? That's perfectly consistent with relativity. Is this point clear? Okay, so you are adding to the Coulomb potential an instantaneous contact interaction. Now, I should add that this is of course an approximation. This, the fact that you are getting an instantaneous contact interaction is because we have expanded this as a power series in P square. Right? If you had actually done the full calculation, what you will find is that the interaction is not contact interaction, but the range of interaction is like the Compton radius of the electron. It's 1 over m. Okay? Okay, this interaction takes place over a distance of 1 over m. But as far as atomic physics is concerned, that's as good as a contact interaction, right? That's this approximation. Okay, the actual result is not contact interaction, but an interaction whose range is given by 1 over the mass of the electron. Is this clear? Okay. So let me now write down the full answer. So after you've taken into account all the normalizations correctly, what you find is that the correction to the potential, see, potential already has an ER squared term, right? Because ER of the proton, okay, two, and now we are talking about the two charges. Okay? Already there is an ER of the proton and ER of the electron. Okay, that term is already there. Okay? On top of that, there is a correction, okay? And that correction is given by minus 4 ER to the 4. So two of the ER factors come from perturbation, because this diagram is a water ER square, right? F2 is a water ER square. The other two come just because the charges that are carried by proton and electron. Okay, that's why it's ER to the 4. So minus 4 ER to the 4 over 15 mR square delta Q. Okay, this is the effective potential that will generate with two charges. Is this? Yes.
Pi,
yes, pi. Oh, no, maybe no, there is no pi. 4 pi will be canceled. Yeah, I think there is a 4 pi which cancels basically this. Like 1 over q square would have given a 1 over 4 pi r, right? But 1 over 4 pi is absorbed into the definition of the like dielectric constants and all. So it's that pi goes away, because that's why this 4 has appeared here. Because you multiply the whole thing by 4 pi. When you have to go through it carefully to see, given this Green's function, you can actually work out what the potential is. So now we can easily calculate its effect on the energy levels, right? Because you can now think of this as a perturbation. Okay, you are already doing order ER square perturbation. Okay. So it's a perturbation over the Coulomb potential. Okay, the Coulomb potential was ER square over R. Now you have added a new perturbation. So you take the original unpartered wave functions and calculate integral psi star psi times this. Right? And this, of course, is a very simple thing that you can integrate, right? So the change in the energy level is given by minus 4 ER square over 15 mR square mod psi of 0. Is clear? Psi star psi multiplied by this potential, we are integrating. This is our function of the electron. Ear to the 4. Pardon? Yes. Ear to the 4. Thank you. This, in fact, is one of the terms that keeps splitting between 2p half and 2s half levels. So you remember this notation, okay, atomic physics notation, 2 is a principal quantum number, right, n equal to 2, right, this is, so n equal to 2, right, p means l equal to 1, this is l equal to 0, and this half refers to j. Here, of course, there's only one possibility, right, j equal to half. Here, j could be half or 3 half. Because you are combining 1 and half. Now, in the standard non-relativistic Schrodinger problem, these are all degenerate. 2s half, 2p half, 2p 3 half are all degenerate. Right? Because you don't care about j. 2s half, 2p half, 2p 3 half are degenerate. When you use Dirac equation, standard Dirac equation, right? What happens, you remember about this degeneracy? There is a relativistic correction from Dirac equation. Right? What that does is that it leaves the degeneracy between j equal to 3 half and j equal to half. Right? When you actually solve Dirac equation, okay, in this background, you find that there is a correction, and that correction basically leaves the degeneracy between j equal to half and 3 half. But that correction is sensitive to the total j. So it doesn't change, leave the degeneracy between 2p half and 2s half. So Dirac equation in the for hydrogen atom problem gives identical energy levels for 2p half and 2s half. This one, on the other hand, is going to leave the degeneracy. Okay, this is going beyond Dirac equation, right? We are introducing the QED effects. Okay. So which one will be lower? What is psi of 0 for P? L equal to 1, right?
Yeah.
What? Psi of 0
cos theta.
Mm-hmm. See, at the origin, the L equal to 1s have 0 value, right? Only the S waves have non-zero value of the wave function at the origin. Okay. All the higher or L partial waves have 0 at the origin, right? So because of this, this will not affect the P level states, but it will affect the S level state, right? And it, because this psi is negative, it will lower the S level state, S states. Okay. So that this is one of the terms that's responsible for this state, okay, between P and S.
Can you please repeat it again?
Yeah, that this one has the psi of 0 equal to 0, the P states.
Yeah, only okay, L equal to 0 starts from infinity and the other start from 0.
Exactly. Okay. So L equal to 0 state, okay, is the one, okay, which is going to get a non-zero contribution. Right? And it's negative. Right? L equal to 1 state will not get a contribution. Right? So because of this, the S state will come below the P state. Right, whereas at the level of the Dirac equation, these are degenerate. Right, 2s half and 2p half are degenerate, but now the S state will come below. This is, if I thought, it's called the lamp shift. Okay, and this is one of the crucial tests of QED, okay, which are done in very early days. Now, I should also add here that this is only part of the contribution. Okay, this is not the full contribution. Okay. If you want to calculate the full contribution to the lamp shift, basically you have to take into account also the fact that the Dirac equation itself is getting modified. Right? This is something we discussed yesterday. Okay. Dirac equation is getting modified because first of all there is a sigma p sitting in the term without the gauge fields. Right? And then the interaction of the gauge fields is modified by the all these various effects, right, including anomalous magnetic moment. So if you want to calculate the full lamp shift, right, this is one part of the lamp shift. This is coming from the fact that even if you don't modify the Dirac equation, right, it's just the proton propagator is getting modified, so the field that the proton produces at the site of the electron, that itself is modified. Okay, that's one effect. But then you have to take into account the fact that the electron motion inside around the proton is now not described by Dirac equation, but by the modified Dirac equation. And that causes further shift in the energy level, and the lamp shift that we measured is actually a combination of all of these. Right? So what I have described here is only a part of the lamp shift, okay, but not the full lamp shift. So this, if you want to see the full calculation, you can look at Ipsix and Zuber. Yeah, I think it's in section 732. Okay, where they have actually solved the Dirac, this modified Dirac equation, and calculated the effect of that modification also on this splitting between P and S. So this is about it. Okay, there are other tests of QED. In fact, one of the one set of very again strong tests of QED comes from what is called the hyperfine splitting. Okay, which are the splitting between the ground state energy levels of hydrogen. Okay. And again, you can the general principle is the same. Right, you take the modified Dirac equation and work out what are the consequences of those equations on the spectrum. But often in this, you also have to worry about the nuclear effects, right? Because part of it, of course, comes from QED, but part of it may also come from nuclear effects, right? Because the proton is not a point-like object, right? It's an extended object, and that itself causes a modification between the kind of interaction the proton and electron has. Okay, so in any given effect, you have to take into account all the possible contributions, and then compare with experiment to see if the QED predictions are correct or not. Okay, so I think I'll stop here. I should say that this calculation you can probably look up. Both Idzik's and Zuber has it. Okay, but Peskin Schroeder also has it.
Peskin.
I think it's in section 7.5. But you can easily find this. So I'll recommend that at least these calculations you do yourself in detail. Okay. And if you get stuck, just look up the appropriate references, okay, in these books to see how these are done. Okay, because these are straightforward calculations from whatever techniques we have discussed, right? You can just apply the techniques straightforwardly to do this calculation, but it's important. Okay, because these, I mean, after only after you do these calculations that you can see the actual test of QED, right? How, because without knowing pi mu nu, you cannot calculate this F2, right? So you have to first calculate pi mu nu and then substitute in the photon propagator. Similarly, you have to calculate the vortex function and the self-energy corrections, and only then you can see what its effect is, will be on the Dirac equation. Okay, so I think I'll